Fine. We had started up with breach of contract. If you recollect, breach means nothing but, does not mean cancellation, but breach means breaking. And I told you there are two types of breaches, anticipatory breach and actual breach. Anticipatory breach is a breach before the due date, and actual breach is a breach which is on the due date. Now, moving on to a very important section, that is damages for breach of contract. Now, there are technically 7 type of damages. But you know, in module, you might not find it like together. It's a little scattered. Students get confused in liquidated damages and so on. But I'll tell you what it is. First of all, let me take the yesterday's example. Yes, if you remember, A was supposed to supply 1,000 goods on 15 Jan and B was going to pay 20,000 for these goods. That means my contract price per piece is 20 bucks, 20 rupees. If I assume market value of these goods on 15 Jan, it was 25. So if you remember, if there is an actual breach, if there is actual breach in this particular case, yes, you will be claiming 5,000. How did you calculate? Because A did not deliver the goods. B will be angry. B will be cancelling the contract on due date, that is 15 Jan. Since he cancels the contract on due date, he will have to buy these goods from the market at the price of 25. How much extra is he paying because of A's breach? 5 rupees per piece. So you will be calculating damages as 5,000. How did you calculate these damages? Basically what you did is, you applied this formula, market value minus contract price. So basically 25,000 minus 20,000. What you just now did is this. Ordinary usual damages. You actually did ordinary usual damages, market value minus contract price. So let me write here, this is nothing but my ordinary damages. Let me change this. Let's say when you entered into a contract on 1st Jan, at that time only, on stamp paper, you had already fixed it. That if either of us breach in future, the amount of liquidated damages will be 6,000 rupees. See, this 6,000 rupees is not some random figure which has come in your mind. You've just assumed certain things, market changes, etc., etc. So you have estimated this to as 6,000. Actually, honestly, you don't know whether the breach is going to happen or not. You don't even know who is going to breach. But you have just covered a situation. If breach happens now, then you are going to claim 6,000 rupees. Aggrieved party will claim 6,000 rupees. So this 6,000, which you have pre-estimated in ordinary breach, they are known as liquidated damages. So let me write it here. It is known as liquidated damages, which is nothing but 6,000. Okay, let me add one more thing. What if I tell you, you know, in this particular case, A has told, A was supposed to deliver 1,000 goods to B. And B told A, listen A, you better deliver me the goods on time, because I have to deliver these goods to someone else. And if you breach, unfortunately, automatically, I will also breach. And if I breach, he, that is C, will claim damages from me. So I'll be claiming my damages from you as well as C's damages from you. That means I'm going to claim both damages from you. And it's right also, because B is facing all this because of A's breach. So he should claim. But you know, if you give this liberty and freedom to B that you can claim both. He too can ask for anything. 1 crore, 5 crore, 10 crore also he can ask for. Therefore, what they have given is, B, you are scared about this situation. That what if you contract with someone else and if he does not deliver, you also can't deliver. You put that situation in your contract beforehand. That is, again, you pre-estimate it. So if I write here, the amount of special damages, if this special circumstances of contract between B and C happen, will be 9,000. Let me tell you, 9,000 is inclusive of both. It includes whatever damages B has faced as well as whatever damages C claimed from B. It is inclusive of both. Now, let me see how much you have understood this. If I change this, let's say you have fixed liquidated damages as 6,000 and you have fixed special damages as 9,000. But this situation between B and C did not ever happen. So there was no actual contract between B and C. There was just contract between A and B. Now, what if I tell you A breaches? How much will B claim? B will claim 5,000, 6,000 or 9,000. Obviously, he will claim 6,000. Because you have already prefixed this for ordinary situations. But let's say the contract between B and C happens. And if A breaches, so he is going to claim 5,000, 6,000, 9,000 or 15,000. Obviously, he'll claim 9,000. See, either you claim special damages or you claim your liquidated damages. And if you notice, both are pre-estimated. Liquidated damages are also pre-estimated. Special damages are also pre-estimated. But the only difference is, liquidated damages can be claimed in normal ordinary circumstances, whereas special damages can be claimed only in special circumstances. That's the difference. So if I write here, special damages in my example is 9,000, which is inclusive of both. See, I took this contract between B and C as special situation. You can take any special situation if you want. Whatever, when you do business, if you are scared about something, if there is any risk, and if both the parties agree to cover that situation in the contract, nothing wrong, as until and unless it is not illegal. It is all going to be fine. So, if I go back to this, see, liquidated damages pre-estimated, special damages pre-estimated, special circumstances. But up till now in all three, what is your purpose? Why do you claim damages? So in all three cases, what is your purpose? Why do you want to claim damages? Your intention is to recover the loss. You just want your loss back. I mean, you are not intending to punish him. You will be like, kya farak padta hai, usko punishment bhi mile. I just want my loss back. If you give me that, I am very happy. So this is your first three. But bachcha, in the fourth one, your intention is not to recover loss because you don't have loss. Your intention is to punish the opposite person. How dare he does like this to me. So your intention is to not to recover loss but to punish. And it can be claimed in two situations. First one, banker wrongfully dishonest customer's check. For example, in my account, I have 1 lakh. And if I issue a check of 10,000, obviously the check should clear. But bank ne galti se mera check bounce kiya. So bank by mistake dishonored my check. So obviously 10,000 check which has been dishonored, it is coming back. So technically I am not facing any financial loss. I am not facing any financial loss because I am not losing 10,000. Similarly, whatever bank charges were debited in my account, they will credit it because it's not my fault. But I can tell the bank, because of your stupid mistake, my reputation is affected. People will now think twice before entering into a contract with me. So now you better compensate me for that loss of goodwill or reputation. And the damages which I am going to claim from the bank are vindictive, punitive or exemplary damages. Now, if you have a question, ma'am, oh, sab to theek hai, how much money can we claim? See, there is no formula given. But they have just mentioned one thing. The amount of check and the amount of damages are inversely proportional. Less the amount of the check, more will be the damages and vice versa. Koi bolega, ma'am, pagal hai kya? No, he's not mad or something. I'll tell you the logic. Let's say you people came to know Mansi ma'am ka 1 lakh ka check bounce hua hai. Theek hai yaar, I don't have 1 lakh. So, it's okay. But let's say you people came to know Mansi ma'am ka 10 rupay ka check bounce hua hai. You will start laughing at me. That means the less the amount of the check, the greater will be the insult and hence more will be the damages. That is the logic. B point, when there is breach of promise to marry. Now, this students find it very stupid and weird. But let me tell you, marriage is a proper contract. When two people get married, it's a contract. And if two people want to get divorced, they can't say, kal se nahi milenge. They have to officially go to the court and get themselves divorced. So what is this breach of contract to marry? A promised to be, I'll marry you. B is like, yes, I will also marry you. But before that date, A C ke saath bhag gaya. So the aggrieved party is B. B can tell A, how dare you do like this to me? You better compensate me for the loss of feelings and reputation and the amount of damages or whatever damages he or she is going to claim. They are known as vindictive damages. Bacha, your intention is not to recover loss, kyunki loss hi nahi ho raha hai. But your intention is to punish the opposite person. Now, if you feel, kya ma'am, kuch bhi, it's very stupid. It is not. Because there are many people in this country or in the world who take advantage by promising marriage. They take advantage physically, mentally, emotionally, financially also. And they promise marriage, they take advantage and then they run away. So for them, for such aggrieved people, they have made this section. Next, nominal damages. Nominal damages, again, your intention is not to recover loss. Your intention is again not to punish, but your intention is to establish a right to sue. You just want to show the opposite person that, boss, don't mess with me, I have a right to sue you. So for example, just for your ego satisfaction, you file a case against someone. Ki, this is wrong, how dare he say like this to me? And the court is actually saying that, Mansi, you are right, he should not have said this. So I did not sue him for money. I just sued him just to show him, boss, how dare you do like this to me? I'm hurt. I did not like this. But since I won the case, naam ke liye compensation mujhe kuch milega because I don't want actual money. So court will say, you know, Mansi has been awarded with rupee one. You will say kuch bhi. Ma'am, for more than 1 rupee, aapka kharcha ho gaya zyada court jane ka. Agreed. But my intention was not to see money, kitna paisa kamaya, kitna paisa gaya. My intention was ego satisfaction, which I got. Jo court naam ke liye award karta hai compensation, it is known as nominal damages. Sixth one, damages for deterioration caused by delay. So if, let's say, I am transporting you cement bags through a ship, and shipping company ko I've given a cement bags that you keep it properly. They acted negligently, they kept the cement bags on the deck of the ship. Now in this particular case, the rain water, sea water got mixed, and by the time the cement reached the shore, it had already turned into stone. So my client is not going to accept these bags. So in this particular case, I can claim damages from the shipping company. Such damages are damages for deterioration caused by delay. Seventh one, remote or indirect damages, door wale damages. They are not actually related to your contract and you can't claim this. If you want example for this, same case, huh? If I stick to this market value wala point, yes, here A breached, actual breach, and therefore B had to go to the market to buy these goods and he is paying 25 rupees, that is 5000 extra. But what B tells A, listen A, because you breached, I had to go to the market to buy goods. And when I went to the market, unfortunately, my wife also came along. And when she came along, she did shopping of 10,000 all thanks to you. So because of you, I have not spent 5,000 extra, I have spent 15,000 extra. My question to you, can you claim 10,000? You want to claim, that's a different matter. But can you claim? No. So you can't claim these damages. These are remote, indirect damages. So seven types of damages, ordinary, liquidated, special, intention to recover loss. Exemplary, intention to punish. Nominal, intention to establish a right to sue. Then delay, and last one is remote or indirect. Coming to your next section which they have given you, or next part, liquidated damages and penalty. Now everyone knows liquidated damages, it's pre-estimated and it will arise in ordinary breach circumstances and your intention is to recover loss, it's a genuine calculation. But bacha, penalty, when I talk about the word penalty, I do not mean the penalty which you pay to government. It's this, the same example if I take. Here, you know, what they did is, they fixed liquidated damages are 6,000. Okay, so if A breaches, he will have to pay 6,000 because you have fixed the liquidated damages as 6,000. But you think from A's point of view. He thinks that, okay, na, even if I breach, how much I'll have to pay? 6,000. Oh, it's in my budget, so I'll breach. Okay, chalta hai. But let me change this. They said in the contract itself that either of us breach, the amount of penalty payable will be 50,000. So now if A breaches, he will have to pay 50,000 penalty. So think yourself in place of A. A sochega, yaar, contract is of 20,000 and if I don't perform, I'll have to pay 50,000. Usse achha to I'll perform the contract. So if you notice, both are pre-estimated. Both will come in breach. But here in penalty, your intention is to punish or to scare someone. Whereas in liquidated damages, your intention is to recover loss. So they have given you here penalty, ordinary circumstances, intention to punish. It's not genuine calculation, but it's a random amount. Indian law ke hisab se liquidated damages and penalty are same. But as per English law, both are different. And if they think that this penalty or liquidated damages is too high, only the court has a power to reduce it. But court cannot increase it. So court can reduce this amount, but they cannot increase it. And lastly, the party which rightfully cancels the contract only can claim damages. So if you want to claim damages, you should rightfully, that means by applying all the rules, you should cancel the contract, only then you can claim damages. Then they have given you this part. Now in module, they have given discharge of contract directly after unit 4. But I take it in the end. The reason being, it's kind of a, you can say, summary. What do you mean by the word discharge? Means coming to an end. Contract, discharge of contract means contract coming to an end. When will contract come to an end? But before that, let me tell you, discharge of party and discharge of contract are two different things. So if I take one example, joint promissors, out of three, one is discharged. That does not mean two are also discharged. Two are still liable. So this is not discharge of contract. This is discharge of party. So discharge of contract and party are different. When will contract come to an end? Performance khatam. Mutual agreement, that is novation. Impossible it has become. Lapse of time. Operation of law. Operation of law is your death, insolvency, etc. Breach, remission, and promissory does not give you facilities, then the contract comes to an end. We have done all of these points. Then additional remedies available in case of breach of contract. Bacha, if breach happens, the aggrieved party can claim damages. But apart from that, what else can he do? He can rescind the contract, yes. He can file a suit for quantum merit. Matlab, some advance, if it is given, he can claim it back. For example, I was supposed to deliver you the goods. You were supposed to pay me 1 lakh, out of which 10,000 you gave me advance. Now, if I breach, you can claim 10,000 back under the principle of quantum merit. Then suit for specific performance. This is very important. If I take example here, now, in this particular case, B is a owner of a museum. He's owner of a museum. A was going to deliver 200 years old antique. And B was supposed to pay 5 crores for this antique. And B was very excited that I'm going to get this antique. So, usne pure city mein publicity ki that, you know, you come to my museum, I'm going to have this antique, this, that. Eventually, A defaults. B is angry. Of course, B can sue A, B can rescind the contract, B can claim damages. But B is like, nahi chahiye mujhe damages. I don't want to rescind the contract. I don't want an advance. I don't even want damages. You know, this is a situation main jahan pe damages calculate hi nahi kar sakta. I cannot estimate my damages. Secondly, even if you give me damages, they are not enough for me. Because it's like I have been insulted. इतना पब्लिसिटी किया एंड सडनली यू डोंट परफॉर्म नाउ, सो पीपल आर लाफिंग एट मी. सो आई डोंट वॉन्ट ऑल दिस. आई वॉन्ट द स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस विच यू हैड प्रोमिस टू मी. आई वॉन्ट दैट एंटीक विच वॉज प्रोमिस टू मी. सो आई वॉन्ट दैट स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस. सो ही कैन फाइल अ सूट फॉर स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस एज वेल. सो इफ यू सी, इफ द डैमेजेस आर नॉट एडिक्वेट, द डैमेजेस कैन नॉट बी एस्टिमेटेड, और योर सब्जेक्ट मैटर इज यूनिक इन नेचर. सी नॉर्मली वॉट यूज टू हैपन इज, इफ ए इज नॉट डिलीवरिंग द गुड्स, यू यूज टू ऑर्डर द गुड्स आउटसाइड. बट हाउ कैन यू ऑर्डर द सेम एंटीक? यू विल नॉट गेट इट बिकॉज इट्स यूनिक इन नेचर. सो यू कैन डिमांड स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस. बट स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस यू कैन डिमांड, बट वेदर यू विल गेट और नॉट, इट विल बी एट द डिस्क्रिशन, दैट इज ऑप्शन ऑफ द कोर्ट. देन दे हैव गिवन यू स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस. यू विल नॉट गेट इफ इट इज पर्सनल स्किल्स. सपोज सिंगिंग, डांसिंग, और यू कैन से पेंटिंग का कॉन्ट्रैक्ट है. यू कैन नॉट फोर्स समवन टू गिव हिज पर्सनल स्किल्स. नहीं देना है, इट्स माई विश. सेकेंडली इफ इट्स कंटिन्यूस इन नेचर. सी वंस कोर्ट कैन फोर्स यू के परफॉर्म कर, सेकेंड टाइम अगेन यू कैन बी फोर्स्ड. एवरी नाउ एंड देन यू कांट बी फोर्स्ड. सो इट इज कंटिन्यूस इन नेचर, देन यू विल नॉट गेट इट. एंड लास्टली सूट फॉर इंजंक्शन. सी स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस एंड इंजंक्शन आर एग्जैक्टली अपोजिट टू ईच अदर. स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस मीन्स कोर्ट फोर्सेज यू टू डू समथिंग. इंजंक्शन मीन्स कोर्ट स्टॉप्स यू फ्रॉम डूइंग समथिंग. इंजंक्शन इज काइंड ऑफ अ रिस्ट्रेंट और स्टे ऑर्डर, यू नो दैट की यू कांट डू दिस. नाउ आई विल टेक वन एग्जाम्पल विच इज योर केस लॉ इट सेल्फ, लूमली वर्सेज वैगनर. बेसिकली वॉट हैड हैपन्ड इज, ए हैड डिसाइडेड टू सिंग इन बीज थिएटर. इज द ओनर ऑफ अ थिएटर एंड he had decided to sing in, she had decided to sing in B's theatre and B was going to pay money. There was one more clause that for next 3 years she cannot work anywhere else. It's valid because she is stopped reasonably. So A ka concert announced hua at B's theatre. Okay, so tickets were sold out and all. A backed out. A bolti hai main perform nahi karungi. Matlab she breached. Not only this, A, C के थिएटर में जाके गाने लगी. That means she breached in both ways. First, यहाँ पे नहीं गा के और यहाँ पे गा के. So B is angry. B can sue, cancel the contract, claim damages. But can B demand specific performance of singing from A here? No, because it's personal skills. So B is like, okay, if I can't demand her performance, at least I can stop her from performing somewhere else. So, in this particular case, here B went to the court and he filed a case for injunction and court stopped A from performing at C's theatre. So, specific performance means court is forcing you to do something and injunction means court is stopping you from doing something. That is your specific performance. With this, the theory of your Indian Contract Act comes to an end. So, ma'am, see, honestly, let me tell you, I have not skipped a single section. So, this is going to be enough. But as in, I'm repeating again and again, please refer this notes for your last day revision. I want you to read proper theory first so that you will be in a position to write. Now, there are two things. Ma'am, what type of questions come? And second, what type of or how are we supposed to present the answers? What I have done is, I have made two papers. And first paper is based on your first 3 units. Unit 1, 2 and 3. It covers all 3 units. Second paper is based on your next 3 units. Performance, breach and contingent and quasi. That will come later. So, we have put some questions and we have also put some answers. So, how to present this? I will compare it with the answer and I'll show you. Okay. First, distinction between void and illegal. So, this distinction between, in our textbook, it is already printed. You can either write this in your table form, void and illegal, which you used to since school. Okay, this is also fine. Or You can explain what is void, you can explain what is illegal, and you can write the points like this. See, illegal is always void, but void is not illegal. Then void agreement, collateral to void is not, collateral to void is valid, but collateral to illegal is void. So you can write it like this also, or you can write T form also. Okay, so this is already mentioned. Then next point, see, this was a question, distinction was a theory question, or in your language I can also call it as a direct question. So you can write this in point wise. Second, this is a situational or a practical question. Two types of questions will be asked, theory and direct. Let me write it here for you properly. Okay, types of questions asked in exam, CAFC, two main types, theory or direct questions and practical questions. Theory questions for 4 marks, 5 marks, 6 marks. Approximately one full scape side is going to be enough. You should write this in point form because it's theory. If you write this in para, it's still okay, but it will be little confusing or irritating for the examiner to read those paras. It's better you write this in point form. Approximately one page. See, little less is also fine. So you are not going to measure it with a tape or lines, but you have to write the content. So this is 4, 5, 6 marks, approximately one page. Practical questions are situational questions. These are little tricky to answer because what happens is theory direct questions you have already solved in 11, 12 school. Explain this, explain that. So you know how it is to be done. But practical question mein they'll give you a situation. When you read the situation, you will know the answer. Trust me on that. But it's very important for you to click which section they have asked you. So when you read the question, read it twice, read the question, and once your answer is there in your mind, okay, this is the answer, think of the section or the legal concept which you used, because you will have to present it in your answer. So again, 4 marks, 5 marks, 6 marks, approximately one full scape page in 3 paragraphs. First paragraph, what law says? As per section, not sec, as per section so and so of the Indian Contract Act. If you don't remember the section, you can always write as per the provisions of the Indian Contract Act. So you write what law says. If there is any related case law, you also write case law. So first paragraph law, second paragraph case law. Second paragraph, in the given question, blah blah blah. So you have to write the question and you have to write one line of your explanation of law and the question. So you will have to mix it up. And third paragraph is a must. It will be your conclusion. Therefore, basically question ka jo last line hai, that you will have to copy. Therefore, contention of A is not valid and so on. So first paragraph law, second paragraph question and the mixture, and third paragraph conclusion. You have to write the answer as if you are explaining a small kid. First paragraph, dekh beta law kya bolta hai. Second paragraph, dekh beta question kya bolta hai. Third paragraph, dekh beta main kya bolta hun. That is very important. Your conclusion. So this is how you'll have to present. Don't worry, we will see. Any girl. Okay, so 3 paragraphs as I told you. Now don't worry, we'll see the questions also and we'll see the answer. So if you see this question, if you read this question, Mr. Singh, an old man, by registered deed of gift granted certain landed property to A, his daughter. As per the terms of the deed, it was stipulated that an annuity of 2000 will be paid every year to B, who is brother of Mr. Singh. See, when you get such questions, na, two, three people involved, you can always draw Singh and A, property is there. And now A has to give money to B, who is Singh's brother. And if it's clicking you, it's a Chinnaya versus Ramaya case law. So she promised. So on the same day, A made a promise to B, ki I will pay you. But A failed to pay. And because B filed a case, she said, I am not liable to pay you anything because you are not having any right of action because you are a stranger to contract. So in this particular case, he is a stranger to contract. Examining the provisions of Indian Contract Act, decide whether contention of A is valid. Answer is no, because it's a case law. If you see how the answer is given. As per this, that means the definition of consideration has been given. Then they have given you explanation and they have also given you the case law. You don't have to explain the whole thing, but maybe 2-3 lines of that case law. Then they have given you in the given question what has happened. And lastly, thus a stranger to contract cannot enforce. You can add one line if you want, therefore contention of A is invalid. This is how you are supposed to present. See, first time it's gonna be little difficult. So don't get worked up, don't get angry, it's okay. And don't curse institute, don't curse us, or don't curse anyone in this world. You just have to study, this is there. Next question. Now, if you see, this is a little tricky question. Again, it's a situational, that is practical question. Sohan induced Suraj to buy a motorcycle, saying that it is in a very good condition. After taking the motorcycle, Suraj complained that there were many defects in the motorcycle. Sohan proposed to get it repaired and promised to pay 40% cost of repairs. After a few days, motorcycle did not work at all. So Suraj wants to rescind the contract. Basically, what is happening is Sohan and Suraj. Sohan sold a bike to Suraj and Suraj paid money. But he induced Suraj. Now, honestly, induced. They have not given you it is done deliberately or it is done innocently. So he just induced him, saying that the bike is in a very good condition. But when he got the bike, he got to know that there are many defects. So it is voidable at the option of Suraj. He can rescind or affirm. But if you see, Sohan proposed to get it repaired and promised to pay 40% cost of repairs. So Sohan ne and Suraj ne, it's kind of an agreement made between both. Ki you know, 40% I will pay, 60% you pay. When you agree to this, you have actually affirmed the contract. Therefore, now Suraj cannot rescind the contract, because when you agreed to share the repairs cost, you have affirmed the contract. See the answer which they have given. Misrepresentation, they have explained you. What happens, aggrieved party can cancel. But here, he cannot rescind the contract, as his acceptance to bear 40% implies to final acceptance of the sale. This is how you are supposed to write. Little bit here and there, if you change the format, it's fine. Just make sure that these contents are available. Law, case law, question and conclusion. Then, next question. What is acceptance? What are the legal provisions of communication of acceptance? So, in this particular case, they have just asked you a direct question. So, you will write the definition of acceptance. See? And the communication of offer as against offeror, as against offeree and so on. Now, here they have put example. This example is optional. Normally, you should put example only if they ask you. Otherwise, it's fine. Then they have explained you something more. How can you, yes, communicate it either by your action or by actual communication. It can be written or oral. Yes. And what is this? Act. So they have explained you all. And why they have explained you all this? It's because it's asked for 6 marks. if they would have asked this for 4 marks, na, I would have stopped with the initial part. 6 marks, so you are expected to write more. Question number 3, exceptions of doctrine of privity of contract, that is stranger to contract cannot sue. So they have given you a situation and they have given you the examples. These examples can be used for your own understanding also. In exam, it depends on how much time you have. They have asked this for 6 marks. If you write example, it will be fine. 6 marks it is. Mere silence does not amount to fraud. Discuss. If you remember, but when there is a duty to speak, or if the silence is equivalent to speech, and if the person does not speak, it will amount to fraud. So now, you know, you just have 2-3 statements here. So what will you write? So they can see, they have given you what is this, mere silence and so on. So what is the rule? What is the exception? So they have explained you so much because they have asked this for 4 marks. If they would have asked this for 2 marks, I would have stopped it here itself. So it depends on how many marks they ask you. It's a direct question. Acceptance to proposal is what a lighted matchstick to a train of gunpowder. Now this question, you know, is little weird. But trust me, it's very simple. You know what is gunpowder, right? Yes, you put fire, then it will blast. So let's say there is gunpowder and if I light a matchstick there, I can't take the matchstick back because it is gone, it's burnt. Similarly, once the proposal is accepted, I can't take it back. So acceptance to proposal is what a lighted matchstick to a train of gunpowder. Yeah, I know it's weird, but they can ask you these questions. So you will have to write extra things they have given, that is acceptance is matchstick, offer is, see, that is the reason we have put this question, that they can ask you any fancy question like this. So offer can be compared to a train of gunpowder, acceptance can be compared to a lighted matchstick. So offer materializes into a contract when it's accepted. Thus once offer is accepted, it becomes a contract and no revocation is possible. So that's what they have mixed up both the things. 4 marks. See, they are writing this point wise. No consideration, no contract, it's pretty simple. That's your exceptions also. See, how many marks they have asked you this? 6 marks. So you have to expand it first to explain what is this. And you better write all the examples. And all the points there. You can add 2 more points which they have given you. That is your charity and you have bailment, 7 points. This was your paper 1 on these 3 units. Okay, so the next paper is on your last 3 units. Unit 4, performance. Unit 5, breach. And contingent quasi, that is 6. Question number 1, discuss the effect of accepting performance from a third person. Now, third person you can accept if you want to, but what are the effects? What is the answer given? See, when a promisee accepts performance of the promise from third person, he cannot enforce it against the promisor. So it is discharging the promisor. Example is also given and they have given you the section as well. So much is given because it's asked for 4 marks. If you notice, 2 marks for this, 2 marks for this. They have not given any marks allocation for example because this is extra. So only if time permits you write it. And only if they ask you, you write it. Second, Explain quasi-contract, state its characteristics. 6 marks, you are expected to write all quasi-contracts. So what is quasi-contract? What are the rules of quasi? And the particular, yes, that is based on prevention of unjust enrichment at the expense of others, and so on. Then, liquidated damages is genuine pre-estimate, whereas penalty is extravagant amount stipulated and it's unconscionable and has no comparison to the loss, which is true, as I told you. So if you see, here they have given you, what is liquidated damages, what is penalty, what is the section. So where a contract is broken, then you will be paying penalty and so on. So they have explained it both. Again, some extra case law they have added. Why? Because they have asked this for 5 marks. Then next, time is essential, but promisor does not perform on time. But after 5 days, the promisor offers to perform. Can promisee accept such performance at the same time claim compensation? Yes, because time is essential, aggrieved party can either rescind or affirm, and he can also claim damages. So here they have mentioned section 55 can claim damages. Then contingent contract, state the rules. You have to write the meaning of contingent contract. What are the rules? Certain, uncertain, whatever we have explained you, all the sections. Happening, non-happening, person, if you remember, impossible, and so on. Where a contract has been broken, the party who suffers by such breach is entitled to receive compensation for any loss caused to him. So obviously you can claim damages. Now since this question is of only 3 marks, they have explained you what is compensation. If they would have asked this for 6 marks, you should have written one line on each damages, because 6 marks. Then basic rule is promisor should perform exactly what he has been promised to perform. What is the obligation? So you have to perform whatever is asked, examples. See, again, they have, see, this is theory, bacha. There's nothing more for me to explain because we have already done the revision. But you have to read the answers properly and write it. Don't write it word by word, same, it's okay, but at least you'll have a rough idea. Next, anticipatory breach is a breach before the time for the performance. So what is the effect of anticipatory breach? So they have asked you anticipatory breach. Either you can rescind the contract immediately or you can wait and so on. See how much they have written. How much they have written. Because it is 5 marks. And if you see our notes, it is only this much. That's the reason I am telling you that you have to keep reading more theory. These notes are going to help you only in the end. Then, A, an Indian contracts to marry B. A is already married, a fact of which B was not aware. So A breaks his promise because he is not getting married again. Thereupon, B files a case against A for breach of contract. A pleads that his promise is impossible of being performed as the law of the country does not permit polygamy. Polygamy means multiple marriages. So can A get away with the plea? Kya A ye bol ke bhag sakta hai ki main already married ho, therefore I can't get married to you again. If you say nahi ma'am, so you can't force him to get married for the second time at the same time. So he can get away with the plea. That means you can't force him to get married, but he will have to pay vindictive damages, breach of contract to marry. So see, they have already explained you what is vindictive damages, breach of promise to marry, in the given question what has happened. Therefore, A can get away with the plea as marriage cannot be forced, but he is liable to pay vindictive damages. then ABC are partners in the firm, jointly they are going to pay 1,50,000 to P. Then C became insolvent and his private assets are enough to pay only half of his share. His share is 50,000 and one half of his share is 10,000. So C can pay only 10,000. And A is compelled to pay the whole amount to P. Examining the provisions, decide the extent to which A can recover it from B. So A, see, 10,000 only C can pay. So the remaining deficit will be borne by A and B. So how much will they be paying? They'll be paying 70,000 each. So A will be claiming 70,000 from B. So see, they have explained you joint promissor, then they have shown you the calculation, so you can recover 70,000 from B. These are your two papers, and as I told you, this is how the presentation is to be done. I want you to make lists. You make a list of case laws, you make a list of Latin terms, you make a list of important legal terms. All these lists are going to help you last day, one day before the exam. Please put in a lot of efforts. I'm sure you don't want to see these books again after 6 months. So with this, we finish our first huge chapter, Indian Contract Act.